Good morning and welcome to the fourth meeting of the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee in 2024. I've received no apologies for today's meeting. The first item on our agenda is to decide whether to take items 6 and 7 in private. Are members agreed? Thank you. Our second item today is consideration of an affirmative instrument, the Community Care, Personal Care and Nursing Care Scotland Amendment Regulations 2024. The purpose of the instrument is to increase the value of payments for free personal care and nursing care by 6.68%. The policy note states that payment rates are being increased in line with inflation using the GDP deflator, with rates increasing from £233.10 to £248.70 for personal care, and increasing from £104.90 to £111.90 for nursing care. The Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee considered this instrument at its meeting on the 23rd of January 2024 and made no recommendations in relation to the instrument. We will have an evidence session on the instrument with the Minister for Social Care, Mental Wellbeing and Sport and Sporting Officials. Once we've had all our questions answered, we will proceed to a formal debate on the motion, and I welcome to the committee Marie Todd, Minister for Social Care, Mental Wellbeing and Sport, Marianne Barker, Unit Head, Adult Social Care Charging and Support from Home, and Claire Thomas, Policy Manager, Adult Social Care Charging and Support from Home, all from Scottish Government. And I invite the Minister to make a brief opening statement.
Convener, thank you very much for the opportunity to speak to the committee today regarding a proposed amendment to the Community Care, Personal Care and Nursing Care Scotland Regulations 2002. The draft regulations before the committee today make routine annual increases to the rates for free personal and nursing care. These payments help cover the cost of those services for self-funding adults in residential care. This year I'm happy to propose an uplift based on the GDP deflator, which will result in an increase of 6.68% to the current rates. The GDP deflator has been used historically as the inflationary measure to increase these rates. This will mean the weekly payment rates for personal care for self-funders will rise from £233.10 to £248.70, and the nursing care component will rise from £104.90 to £111.90. It's estimated that this will cost around £11.5 million in the next financial year. This will be fully funded by the Scottish Government, with additional investment in the local government settlement as outlined in the recent 24-25 Scottish budget. The most recent official statistics show that over 10,000 self-funders receive free personal and nursing care payments. They should all benefit from these changes. Convener, I'm happy to take any questions from the committee.
Thank you very much, Minister, and we will move to questions. And Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you, Minister, for your opening statement. I'd just like to query that increasing the rate above inflation for the last 3 years, the Scottish Government has effectively admitted that in line with inflation, uplifts are simply not enough to meet the rising costs of providing care, yet this statutory instrument puts the rate in line with inflation in the coming financial year. So who does the Minister intend to see meeting the gap that are rising between rising costs and the actual capacity to pay for them, and what is covered in the local government settlement? Is it for already councils that are under significant financial pressures in the forthcoming budget settlement to find that extra financial capacity rather than the government centrally?
Given the challenging financial context we are facing, I am happy that we've been able to increase the rates by 6.68%. That's investing an additional £11.5 million through the local government settlement to do this. It is for local authorities to make decisions on how they spend their funding at a local level.
Does the Minister not accept, though, that over 80% of local government finance is determined by central government grants, and that therefore constrains their capacity to meet the other half or the other side of the equation?
So traditionally, this payment has increased in line with inflation since 2010. In the first few years of its existence, up to 2007, when the SNP government came into power, it wasn't increased at all, not in line with inflation and not at all. From 2007 to 2010, the payment rate was negotiated between ourselves and local authorities, and from 2010 to 2020, it was increased using the GDP deflator. As you say, the last 3 years, there has been an above-inflation rise to it. Unfortunately, the financial context this year means that that cannot occur again. But in the financial context that we are experiencing, I am pleased to be able to increase it in line with the GDP deflator as stated.
Okay. And in terms of this GDP deflator that you're setting it to, what assessment has the government made of any impact of this rate upon the delivery of personal care? And can the minister guarantee that people will still be able to access the care they need and that it will remain free at the point of use?
So we haven't done an impact assessment because it's not a new policy, it's continuing an existing policy, so we haven't done a full impact assessment. But yes, we expect this to support everyone who is self-funding within the system, which we think is about 10,000 people in Scotland.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, Carol Morgan.
Thank you, Convener. Just really to follow up on the points made just around your discussion there about impact assessment. So in the previous years, you were concerned that the rate was increasing more. Do you have concerns this year again that that will be the case and that local authorities, local government would need to meet the costs that are not going to be in the settlement agreed?
So certainly in the past 3 years, our ambition has been to give above inflation settlements. And unfortunately, the financial context we find ourselves in this year is not enabling us to do that. Local authorities will make their own decisions on their local priorities as they are democratically elected to do.
Okay. Just to be clear, but in your modelling, I suppose you are anticipating that local government will need to make some contribution to costs because you, like in the previous 3 years, you think there will be an increase in costs?
So I'm going to ask my official Claire to come in here and respond to that line of questioning.
So those free personal nursing care rates are set out in the legislation, so they're set rates. There shouldn't need to be a contribution from local authorities. Those contracts and the rates that self-funders pay are private arrangements between individuals and the provider.
OK, thanks.
And Sandish Kohani.
Thank you, Minister. Just to pick up again on what Paul and Carol were asking, the £11.5 million that will be the cost, is that £11.5 million the central government has put into a budget which would allow local authorities to make their own choice? Is that an extra £11.5 million central government has put in? Or is it that they have to, that £11.5 million cost is something that central, that local governments have to just find?
So that additional £11.5 million is additional funding which is put in to fully fund this uplift.
Thank you.
I've not had any indication that any other members wish to ask questions, so we'll move to agenda item 3, which is the formal debate on the instrument on which we've just taken evidence. Minister, can I ask you to speak to and move motion S6M 11853?
I'm happy to move motion S6M 11853 that the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee recommends that the Community Care, Personal Care and Nursing Care Scotland Amendment Regulations 2024 be approved.
Thank you, Minister. Members should not put questions to the Minister during the formal debate, and officials may not speak in the debate, and I invite any members who wish to contribute to the debate. Mr Sweeney.
Thank you, Convener. I have concerns about this statutory instrument being recommended to Parliament because the Scottish Government has previously set the rate above inflation for the last three financial years to help redress the cost of providing personal and nursing care, which has increased significantly and payments have not kept pace with this. By their own admission, then, this rate increase in line with inflation is insufficient to meet the rising real costs of delivering personal care. The Scottish Government expect members to trust in their vision, which we have not yet seen, for a national care service which delivers, in their own words, consistent and high standards, yet this statutory instrument demonstrates an inability to adequately resource a basic tenet of social care. Whilst we won't be voting actively against the statutory instrument, I do have concerns about recommending this rate to Parliament, which falls short of what local government need to provide personal care.
Thank you. I've had no indication that any other member wishes to speak. Minister, could you sum up and respond to the debate, please?
As stated during questioning, this uprating is fully funded by Scottish Government, and local authorities have additional income into their budget in order to ensure that it is paid. I'm happy to put this to a vote with the committee.
Thank you very much, Minister. The question is that motion Essex M11853 be approved. Are we all agreed? Thank you. The committee is agreed. That concludes consideration of the instrument, and I'll now briefly suspend the meeting to allow a changeover of witnesses for our next item. The next item on our agenda is the first of our two oral evidence sessions as part of our post-legislative scrutiny of the Alcohol Minimum Pricing Scotland Act 2012. And I welcome to the meeting Alison Douglas, Chief Executive of Alcohol Focus Scotland, Dr Alistair McGilchrist, Chair of Scottish Health Action on Alcohol Problems, Tracy McFall, Chief Executive of Scottish Recovery Consortium, and Justina Murray, CEO of Scottish Families Affected by Alcohol and Drugs. And we'll move straight to questions, and Sandish Gulhani.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. Thank you for coming in. Alison, may I start with you, please? Can I ask, how accurate has the Sheffield model been in each of its iterations prior to its update? They'll do it automatically.
Sorry, it's automatic, is it?
Yeah, they'll do the microphone
automatically. Thank you, Dr. Gulhani. So the Sheffield modelling predicted that there would be a 3.5% decrease in consumption, which is actually pretty much what we have seen in practice. So that, in terms of the effect on consumption, it has been pretty accurate. In terms of the effect on health outcomes, it was actually a very conservative estimate, and the effect that we've seen in the real world has been significantly higher. I think they were probably quite deliberate in being cautious about the expected health benefits. But in practice, we have seen, as you know, it was predicted to save 60 lives in the first year of operation. In practice, it has saved 156 lives. So that was significantly greater than was predicted. But I think the key thing is that the theory of change, which was behind this Parliament's support for minimum unit price, has, through the evaluation, been fairly well borne out. So the real-world evidence that we've been able to add through this very comprehensive evaluation to the evidence that came from other countries, but also from the Sheffield modelling, is all painting a picture that minimum price is operating in the way that we expected it to. It is affecting high-strength, low-cost drinks the most. It is thereby reducing consumption, particularly amongst those who are drinking above low-risk guidelines. And it is reducing alcohol harm. And the goal, way that we can measure that is obviously through alcohol-specific deaths. So there are deaths that are caused directly as a consequence of alcohol and through no other cause. So that's the 156 that I alluded to. But in addition, we have a whole range of conditions, such as cancers, heart, cardiovascular disease, and minimum unit price is also having an effect on those. There's an estimate of an additional 112 lives saved each year due to minimum unit price. And that's the reason that over 30 organisations, the Direction of Public Health, have endorsed the evidence which we've given to the committee and that of SHAP, because there's a widespread understanding through the medical community, through public health professionals, through children's charities, that minimum unit price is working, but that it needs to be uprated.
Okay, so a number of things that you said in your opening answer to me. You said 156 lives like a fact. That's an estimate based upon modelling which is under intense scrutiny. You talked about comprehensive evidence, and only one out of the 30 papers that were evaluated is what you were speaking about. And you're speaking... the other thing that I really do want to get into here, and I wonder if I might be able to bring Justina in prior to coming back to you, Alison, is about dependent drinkers. So, thank you. Is about dependent drinkers. So, how has MUP affected dependent drinkers?
Okay, thank you. I think I'm going to preempt this with a slightly different comment, which is, you know, I'm here today representing Scottish families, so on behalf of families affected by alcohol and drugs. And I think families are just getting a little bit frustrated that this is still being debated so many years down the line. You know that we've lost over 11,000 people specifically to alcohol over the past decade, many times more than that if we look at, you know, alcohol-related conditions and other things linked, like violence and accidents and so on. And, you know, families don't really understand why this is still being debated. You know, they want to see action. They want to see action on other issues as well, marketing, availability and treatment. And, you know, we are part of the public health community, not just in Scotland. We're part of the international public health community. And that community is united in believing the evidence and understanding the evidence that, you know, MUP saves lives. So, you know, It is designed as a whole population approach. We can see it has reduced consumption, it has reduced hospital admissions, and it has reduced deaths.
Sorry, can I ask you for the evidence that it's reduced hospital admissions, please?
The evidence has all been presented to you.
Was it statistically significant?
The papers we've shared show that hospital admissions have reduced by 13.4%.
Was it statistically significant?
I'm here as a charity CEO. I'm not going to start arguing with you over statistical significance. I think you should be focusing on the fact that MUP has saved lives. I think you're possibly the only person in the room, I'm not sure, who doesn't believe the evidence. But I think, you know, I am standing firm with the public health community across the world, saying that price is the most effective mechanism for reducing harm and reducing deaths.
Sorry. So, I do believe the evidence. I want to make that abundantly clear, and this is why I'm asking the questions. And I asked you specifically at the very beginning, what does MUP do to dependent drinkers, which you haven't answered yet?
You're correct, I haven't answered it. You know, many of the families that we support are families whose loved ones are drinking at, you know, hazardous, harmful and dependent levels. And price is one of many factors that they talk about in changing their loved ones' behaviour. The evidence on dependent drinkers was never supposed to be what we pinned the success of MUP to. It is a whole population measure, and it has worked as a whole population measure. And we know where people are dependent drinkers. Their needs are very complex. They're very specific. So, you know, one tool in the toolkit is never going to work for all dependent drinkers. You know, some drinkers have said, yes, they have changed their behaviour based on MUP, but also we need to look at these other tools in the toolkit. And instead, we just, you know, focus all of the time on MUP and talk about MUP all of the time. But it's got to sit alongside availability and marketing and treatment.
And we certainly will be coming on to those questions. But again, you haven't answered my question about dependent drinkers, because
I said their needs are very complex and specific. And so price alone is not going to be the only thing that's going to impact their drinking. I think that is an answer.
So the evidence shows that dependent drinkers are spending more on their alcohol consumption. And so, Alison, if I may come back to you, what has happened to help dependent drinkers who are spending more money to try to help them come away from alcohol? So, for example, alcohol brief interventions or people seeking treatment. How has that worked for dependent drinkers?
To come back to the point about has minimum unit price worked for dependent drinkers, let's be absolutely clear. It was not the purpose of minimum unit price to change the drinking of dependent drinkers. The purpose was to reduce consumption amongst people who are drinking above the low-risk guidelines. Just to give you a sense of scale in relation to that, roughly about 1% of the Scottish population is alcohol dependent. That's about 50,000 people or so. 23% of us are drinking above the low-risk guidelines. That's well over 1 million of us. So that's what we mean when we talk about a population-based measure. And the effect has been greater on those who are drinking at higher levels. When it comes to dependent drinkers, I think, as Justina has indicated, if people are waking up in the morning and they are psychologically and physiologically dependent on alcohol, the first thing that comes to their mind is not, you know, how much am I paying for my alcohol? It is, I need alcohol now to get me through this morning. And so... it's really clear that people who are in that extreme position need more intensive support in order to overcome their alcohol problem. But what I can tell you, and I'm sure Tracy can add to this, is that people who are dependent on alcohol, or rather who are in recovery from serious alcohol problems, are very clear when I've been speaking to them that minimum unit price would not have changed their dependence on alcohol, but they wholeheartedly support minimum unit price as a preventative measure to ensure that people don't come along behind them and experience dependence and the severe problems that they and their families have had to contend with. So the message from people in recovery is, please get on with renewing and uprating minimum unit price, because it's such an essential component of the wide range of things that we need to be doing to tackle the alcohol problem in Scotland.
Sorry, see, I
move on. You've had 12 minutes of questions and answers, and we've got lots to get through.
I'm
going to move to Tess White.
Thank you, Convener. May I ask my question to Dr. McGilchrist, please, initially, and then if another member of the panel would like to answer this question. So in terms of looking at the facts and the data, alcohol deaths are the highest now since 2008. And the number of male deaths has remained unchanged, yet the data from 2022 shows that the number of female deaths has risen by 31 to 440. So how does minimum unit pricing help reduce the number of female deaths? Thank you.
Thank you. The question about female deaths, this is quite a specific area, and we may get into some quite close detail here, but when you look at the modelling for minimum unit price, when we set it at 50 pence, Parliament's unanimous agreement, remember 50 pence was first suggested in 2012. So by 2018, 50 pence was already kind of on the borderline of how effective it would be because of the effect of inflation over that time. And the modelling suggested that at that 50 pence level, MUP is actually less effective on preventing female deaths than preventing male deaths. And it is interesting that a 50 pence has been effective over the last 5 years, but it's probably not been consistently effective over those 5 years. It's becoming less effective as time passes because of the effect of inflation. 50 pence now isn't what it was in 2018, perhaps what it was in 2012. And it's, I think, reasonable to speculate that that very disappointing and interesting small increase in female deaths between 2021 and 2022 might reflect that MUP is becoming less effective, particularly in women. We don't really understand why that is. It's maybe because women drink a different pattern of products compared to men, you know, less likely to drink the more the cheapest end of the range in terms of cider, etc., compared to drinking wine. Wine's relatively not affected by MUP at that 50 pence level. But if you don't mind, I really can't let a couple of the comments that have gone previously go unchallenged in terms of an answer. So if you don't mind giving me just 2 minutes to come back on a couple of points. That, I realise that. Very briefly. OK, so Dr. O'Gahanny stated that only 1 in 30 of the studies showed this. That's a very misleading statement, I'm afraid. There was only one study which looked at population-level deaths on hard data, i.e. National Statistics on Deaths and Admissions, and that study showed a clear difference between Scotland, where there is MUP, and England, where there isn't. This was not modelling, this was looking at real-world data. So to suggest that 156 is based on modelling is incorrect. This is real-world data. It's an estimate, because they're talking about percentage differences, but it's not a model. You asked about the significance of the hospital admissions. Again, this gets very, very detailed, but when medical studies talk about statistical significance or clinical significance, they talk about a 95% certainty that it couldn't have happened by chance. So the data on hospital admissions showed 94% certainty, p equals 0.06. Yes, it didn't cross the 95% certainty, but you can draw your own conclusions about 94% versus 95% in terms of whether there's an effect or not. And finally, just one final point before we go on to other matters. The question about dependent drinkers. I think it's important that everybody understands what we're talking about here. Harmful drinkers, people drinking in excess of 35 units for men, 50 units for women, constitute probably around 5% of the population, dependent drinkers 1%. These dependent drinkers, people who are already addicted, to use that term, to alcohol, of course MUP is not the solution for them. The whole point of MUP is to prevent people getting to that point. It's a preventative measure.
Thank you, Convener. Can I go back to my question?
Sorry.
It's like gone off piste.
Apologies.
If we can go back on piste, which is female deaths.
Yeah, I understand that.
And it is statistically significant. 31 to 440 is a huge increase. So we're looking at no change in male deaths since 2008.
Yep.
But the female deaths are, it's dramatic. So, and you talk about modelling and speculative, but if you actually look at the data from the National Records Scotland, the data doesn't support what you're saying. And what you've confirmed is that female deaths, you just don't know if MUP affects. So I'd just like to say there's no answer. So can I invite Alison Douglas, please?
I need to perhaps finish my answer then if I didn't clarify to you. What I'm saying is that MUP at 50 pence is less effective on women than it is on men, and the data is bearing that out. So if you want to solve the problem of why it's less effective on women, the clear answer is to uprate MUP.
I dispute that. Can I ask Alison Douglas, please? Thank you.
Thank you. So I think in relation to deaths as a whole, what we saw was...
Sorry, the question's about women.
Yeah, I'm going to get there. So deaths as a whole doubled between the 70s and the 2000s. And women are still much less likely than men to die. However, because of a number of different changes in society, women are drinking at higher levels than they have previously. And that what we've seen in terms of what is consumed in Scotland is increases in the, and across the UK, is an increase in wine in particular. And wine is often favoured by female drinkers. So we've seen the increasing social acceptability of women drinking and the increased availability of wine and the increased acceptability of wine drinking. And I think these things over time have contributed to an increase in female deaths. So we talked earlier about alcohol-specific deaths, which are... three-quarters of those would be alcoholic liver disease, and Dr. McGilchrist can speak to what clinicians are seeing in terms of having very young women presenting where they hadn't seen that previously. But also many of those conditions, the alcohol-related conditions, can take 10-20 years to manifest themselves. So, for example, alcohol-related cancers, breast cancer, you know, those can take 10-20 years to manifest themselves. So I think part of what we're seeing is probably because of the increased drinking amongst women, that is flowing through into increased deaths.
Thank you. Nobody's disputing those facts, but just disputing the question of MUP on female deaths, alcohol-related deaths. Thank you.
Thank you. And Carol Morgan.
Thank you. Just a question for Dr. McGilchrist. I'm interested in the medical community that works in this area. I'm sure you've discussed MUP as part of that whole package. So in terms of the medics that work in this area, are they generally quite convinced that this has helped and that we should uprate it?
Yes, there's no doubt that the MUP has, you know, maybe not unanimous, but near unanimous support from the medical community and from the health community in general. Without indulging you too much, I mean, the background to this is that my clinical career is spent as a liver doctor. And as you've heard, not only are most alcohol-specific deaths due to liver disease, it works the other way around too, most liver deaths are due to alcohol. So I've got lots of folk in my ward who are dying of liver disease. I was in the infirmary last week speaking to my colleagues, and, you know, it was just a usual week. 18 out of the 19 patients in the ward had 89 to 19 patients with liver disease had liver disease due to alcohol. So that's a scale of the problem. The last death they had at the weekend was a 40-year-old who had two young kids. It's so frustrating that it comes to you when it's at an irreversible stage. You know, cirrhosis is silent until you have advanced disease. And so to have a mechanism that's preventative, you know, that's why I got interested in this stuff in the first place. You know, if you can prevent them getting it in the first place. So, you know, I've come to this public health stuff a bit later, and, you know, I'm reading the evidence. You know, it's actually clear that we've known what to do for a long time. We've known what's effective, affecting price, availability, attractiveness, marketing, we've been speaking about a little bit. So to have this targeted, progressive policy which reduces health inequalities, the medical community is delighted. We're not seeing it on the ward yet, to be honest. You know, and you know, some of the deaths which Ms. White has referred to, it's important to realise that we're still seeing the aftermath of the COVID pandemic, which has had a major effect on everything, but including alcohol deaths and liver deaths. And so it's more important than ever that we use effective measures such as MUP and to at a proper level.
Thank you.
We have got a lot to get through this morning.
Sorry.
So can I ask both committee members and witnesses if they can keep their answers concise, please? And I move to Emma Harper.
Thanks. Thank you, convener. Good morning, everybody. So over the weekend, I was reading about minimum unit pricing policy that's been implemented in other European countries. And I do declare an interest as a registered nurse, former liver transplant nurse. So I'm interested in, like, what do we... Other countries are adopting MUP in some form or another. All other European countries have got some form of taxation on alcohol anyway. So for me, there's one report that's called No Place for Cheap Alcohol, the Potential Value of Minimum Pricing for Protecting Lives. So I'd be interested to hear from you about, you know, what we can learn from other countries and then perhaps... The impact of the pandemic would be a second question.
Shall I take that?
I'm happy to come in on the pandemic, but I'll leave the other countries to you.
The international community is the eyes are on Scotland because it was the first country in the world to introduce MUP, having known for a long time that pricing is effective, but pricing regulation is generally by taxation. The attraction of MUP is this idea that you target the cheaper drinks, which the heavier drinkers take. Prior to Scotland, there was a few provinces quite a number of provinces in Canada who have something similar. There's now one province in Australia, Northern Territories, mm-hmm. two other areas within the British Isles, Ireland and Jersey, I think in the Channel Isles. The ones in Europe in general are slightly different. They often target one particular drink. You know, in Russia, it's vodka. In Ukraine, it was interesting. Ukraine have a variety of specifically spirits. We're lucky in Scotland that we have very good evaluation, good data. Few other areas have such good data, so that's why they're interested in watching what's happening in Scotland. That's one of the reasons that the industry is so worried, if you like, because if it seemed to be effective, then other countries will adopt it. But you're still only talking about a handful of countries, and you could ask yourself why that is. Maybe it's the power of the industry. Most people just rely on taxation, which is a much blunter tool.
Okay, thanks. And the pandemic, Justina.
Yeah, if I could come in on that. So in December 2020, when we thought actually the pandemic was tailing off, Scottish Families produced a report called Lockdown and Beyond. And in that, we talked about that impact of the pandemic on families. And we really saw, like, we don't get involved as a charity where there's alcohol use in a family or drug use in a family. It's where there's harm. And I think during the pandemic, we really saw for a lot of families that use becoming harm. And we talk about both new families and existing families. So there was already families pre-pandemic where they knew there was an issue with alcohol, for example. But actually, during the pandemic, alcohol use increased. and it was more likely to be happening in the home because of the closure of hospitality and stay-at-home rules, and also the other members of the house were also more likely to be at home. And then there was also new families where they weren't actually aware there was an issue before, but, you know, it was hard to hide that during the pandemic when, again, everybody was at home. And all the things that families do normally to keep themselves well, you know, maybe to go to work, to go to school, to go to college, to meet their friends, to go for a swim, the gym, whatever, none of that was available. So everybody was kind of stuck in the house with this alcohol use increasing. So it really was what we call a kind of pressure cooker situation. And of course, alongside that, there was the closure of a huge number of treatment services and support services that could no longer be accessed. So people who were concerned about their drinking were phoning the Scottish Families Helpline because they were trying to contact services and nobody was answering the phone, or there was a voicemail and nobody was getting back to them. So, you know, it was just like a perfect storm. And obviously, once that box has been opened, you can't just say, oh, well, the pandemic's over now, we'll just pretend that never happened. You know, that harm is ongoing, and we're not really seeing the pickup in treatment services and support services, for example, that we need.
So has the pandemic affected our ability to capture further evidence, or it's also obviously informed the way that some evidence has been gathered, because we saw higher levels of drinking, as you've described, Justina. So does that mean that minimum unit pricing, we just need to continue and continue to get some, you know, further robust evidence? I see Alison's got her hand up.
Thank you. Yes, as Justina said, you know, the scale of the problems increased. And I think, like so many other areas of our health, we have this COVID hangover or unfortunate legacy on our health, whether it's cancer or it's mental health or it's alcohol. There are ongoing effects from COVID, that people who started to drink more during the pandemic unfortunately don't appear to have reverted to their previous patterns of drinking since the pandemic. And that means that we have an even greater kind of public health emergency on alcohol than we would otherwise have had. And I really fear, you know, we could be heading back to record levels of deaths if we don't do something. Part of that response needs to be minimum unit price and uprating it, but there's a whole range of other things which we also need to be doing. But I think to your point about the evidence base, the study which Public Health Scotland did around the deaths and the hospital admissions, not only did it use the kind of gold standard data, but they used the methodology which would be largely accepted as the, you know, the best possible methodology for the statistical analysis. And they did a whole range of controls, and that included stopping the data before the pandemic and looking at whether there was a material change. And what they found was, by using England as the comparator, there was the same sort of changes in deaths were evident, the same direction of travel that deaths went up significantly. But while in Scotland they went up by 22%, they went up by 30% in England. And they concluded that the only plausible explanation for that was the introduction of minimum unit price.
OK, thank you. Thanks.
Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you to the panel. I'd just like to ask if any of the panellists have concerns that there may have been unforeseen negative impacts on health-related outcomes which have not been picked up by the Public Health Scotland evaluation, and if there are any other aspects that you would have liked to have seen measured or have found it difficult or impractical to evaluate. So one example that I have concerns about is potential substitution with benzodiazepines, so-called street Valium.
Shall I take that? I'll start anyway, others can chip in. One of the points about the Public Health Scotland-led evaluation was how comprehensive it was. You know, for the past few years, if you went to an international meeting and said, we've never seen a measure that's had undergone such scrutiny, which includes what we're doing in this room. So the evidence that they wondered about substitution, both in terms of other products such as benzos or illegal illicit alcohol, not really a problem in the UK to be honest, or cross-border trade. So they did look at these three things and found no significant evidence. There was a little bit of press just about a year or two into MUP about a couple of examples of people who had taken benzos, but what you found when you looked at the evidence was that they found no evidence that anybody who wasn't using street drugs or not non-prescription drugs started to do it. Some who were using both perhaps changed the emphasis of what they were doing. So I'm not too concerned about the illicit thing. It hasn't proved to be a big problem.
Paul, thanks. Just to come in from a really practical community-based level in the communities that we work across, in my engagement over a number of years with communities who use both alcohol and drugs, that has not been the case. So there is that evidence base, but in real-life communities, there was a concern that that would happen. We haven't seen that in the communities that we work with. I think we need to keep our eye on that really, really closely. But we haven't seen that, and that's from real-life communities that we engage with on a day-to-day basis. We haven't seen that.
That's great. Thanks. Thank you.
Thank you. David Torrens.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, witnesses. And I know every one of you have touched on it slightly, but to make sure it's on record for the committee, what would you say to those who have concluded from available evidence that minute pricing is not working in targeting problem drinkers?
I'm happy to start to make a really broad point. This is not only about minimum unit pricing. This is about the other things that we need to wrap around that. So that's about early intervention, prevention and education. It's about access to treatment. It's about minimum unit pricing. It's about opportunities about employment. It's about what happens after treatment. So there's something more broadly that we really need to look at this. In the recovery communities that we've spoke with, and my experience in the sector, this is one tool, and it needs to be in the suite of a number of different tools. And just another very broad point. We're talking about alcohol consumption here. I was at committee just before Christmas, cross-party committee, where we're talking about drug deaths. There is connections across alcohol, drugs, mental health, justice, homelessness, domestic violence. From a policy perspective, we need to be joining the dots, and we need to be joining those dots locally as well. So from a broad point of view, that's the two things that I'd like to get across. This is not just about minimum unit pricing, because if it is, it won't work. We need access to treatment. We need access to recovery. We need access to opportunities. And all of this is underpinned by poverty and inequality that we really need to focus on too. Thank you.
Can I say add a little bit? I think, just to a risk of slight repetition, I talk about problem drinkers all the time too. It's common parlance, but we have to be careful what we're talking about here. The harmful drinkers, and as I said, the dependent drinkers are a small proportion of those. The people who I think MUP has had least effect on are the dependent drinkers. But I think the people who has had most effect on are those who are drinking at a harmful level, or certainly hazardous or harmful level. And I'll quote you two bits of that. One is that when they looked at the sales data, and of course, remember that sales data is more robust than survey data. A survey, you're asking people questions about how much they drink, and maybe the recall is not very good, maybe they're not always entirely honest, and maybe you don't reach the people who you need to with surveys. So sales data showed that not only had sales fallen from off sales, but from data collected on till receipts, the households who bought the most alcohol were the ones who had seen the biggest change. So that's encouraging. And the second thing is, again, coming back to my liver disease hat, when you look at that difference between Scotland and England, those deaths that were happening in England that haven't happened in Scotland, you might have expected to happen, it's all liver deaths. Now, I can tell you, all my liver patients are very heavy drinkers. And so there's no way that those deaths would have been... You've seen that difference in Scotland and England unless heavy drinkers were not being influenced by MUP.
Convener, I think my other questions have been answered.
OK, thank you. Ruth Maguire.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. Thanks for being with us. I suppose hearing Justina talk about the 11,000 people lost to alcohol, think about the families and children around them. So I'd like to ask about children and families. I hear a bit of the frustration about us just talking about minimum pricing. However, that's the legislation that we're scrutinising, but do feel free to add extra in amongst that. I think my questions would tend to be for Justina and, forgive me, it's terrible, I can't see names. Tracy, apologies, Tracy. As I think you'll have rich evidence from us, from families. The Public Health Scotland evaluation report says researchers felt unable to determine if minimum unit alcohol pricing had a positive or negative impact on the lives of children and young people affected by parental drinking, and said there was no evidence in any change of parenting outcomes. I think we would probably all intuitively understand the harm that drinking causes. I wonder if you just want to say a bit about the impact on children and families.
I think one of the issues for children and young people and adult family members actually is so much of this is hidden. So, you know, there was a question earlier about, you know, needing more research or more evaluation. And I think, you know, we know that there's so much stigma and shame and secrecy around alcohol use within the family that I think we can be quite confident that most of that harm is hidden. Mm-hmm. And particularly where, you know, so many people outwardly, you know, they might have a nice house, a nice car, you know, great job, and actually there's a lot of drinking going on behind the scenes. And there's really very little support for families. I would say there's the best support for children is where there's opioid use in the family, and particularly where there's a single parent or both parents using that. I think there's a whole lot of families where there's alcohol use, and actually it's not on anybody's radar because children are attending school and, you know, young people attending college and so on. So I do think we need to talk more openly about, you know, what's going on. And I think we've got this really contradictory approach to alcohol in Scotland, where we use it to, you know, mark every single occasion, you know, hatches, matches and dispatches. And yet, if anybody develops a problem, then we don't really want to know about it. So I think that's my main issue for families, is that just so much of this harm is hidden and the support's not there for them.
Thank you.
Yeah, I agree with Justina, and there is a huge amount of stigma attached to alcohol use. So whilst it is hidden, it's very difficult for families and family members, and therefore the impact on children, to come forward into treatment services. And I think there's a reality here that there's actually less treatment services to support alcohol than there ever has been in Scotland. So if families identify there is an issue, where do they go? And that's why Justina says that there are calls to the helpline, because families are really struggling when they identify there's an issue on where they get that help. And there's a massive stigma attached to that. So I suppose there's parallels in relation to some of our learning around the drugs work and the national mission. We could learn from that in relation to some of the work we've done around stigma. We don't need to start from a blank piece of paper. And again, that's why we really need to be looking at this across portfolio approach. So I agree with Justina, and we still need access to treatment if families identify that. And we do need to do more research, but you need to be using organisations like Scottish Families and Scottish Recovery to get access to those families, because more than likely they'll probably phone Scottish Families first before accessing treatment services.
Okay. And Convener, if I may just come back in.
Yes.
As this is post-legislative, that's my least favourite word to say, I find it really difficult, scrutiny. Often when legislation's moving through Parliament, we'll talk about the other things that are needed. So I'm sure at the time, this was a little bit before my time because it was 2012, the need for treatment and additional interventions would have been spoken about. Has there been progress on those types of things? Thank you.
Yes, I think that's maybe the frustration you're hearing today is, you know, in Scotland's alcohol framework and in Rights, Respect and Recovery, there's multiple commitments around price, availability, marketing and treatment and support, and actually so much focus, so much, you know, funding for research has gone on to that, the MUP quite rightly, it was well evaluated and so on, but actually, what about everything else? And I think that's the point, that families are just really reaching breaking point with all of the other stuff that needs to be looked at as well. And we're obviously talking about costs a lot this morning, but when we started to talk to families about cost of living issues, when that was first kind of hitting the press and so on, you know, that wasn't even in the top 10 things that families are worried about and is keeping them awake at night, which is not to say that families don't have cost of living worries, but we've actually talked about the cost of loving. That is the cost that they face. It's really relentless every day. Yes, there's financial, there's practical, there's health costs. Life is chaotic. And so within that, yes, price is a factor, but also all of these other things need to be addressed.
Thank you. Thanks, Convener. Ivan McKee.
Thank you very much and good morning, panel. Hugely important subject, and I think there's probably many of us that have had family members or friends that have succumbed to alcohol harm and passed away earlier than they should have done. I wanted to focus a wee bit on the economics of this, and so I'm going to be a bit geeky to kick off with. Alistair, you've got a chart in your submission, the Sharp submission, and I'm just trying to get my head around what the labels are on the axis. I'm assuming the have you got it to hand there? Yeah. Yeah, I'm assuming the left-hand side is units of alcohol per person per year. The right-hand side, the relative numbers there, what are those? 100, 200, what?
Yes, I'm not sure I know, but okay. I can tell you what. This is a slide from a very old piece of data in the 70s and 80s, actually, which first drew attention to the fact that there's an absolutely clear relationship between how much we... I think this is... let me just see. Yeah, this is about consumption, not harm. How much we drink in relation to how affordable it is. So price relative to income, which is the right-hand graph there, is its affordability. Mm-hmm. You know, Alison's alluded to the fact there's been a huge increase in alcohol deaths in many countries, but particularly Scotland and the UK, since I graduated in 1979. And, you know, at that point, you know, deaths were at a bad level, but much more manageable. And it increased hugely over the last 30 years. The primary reason for that is because alcohol is much more affordable. You know, alcohol goes up a little bit in price, but our income and our disposable income goes up much more. So when this crisis really hit the public eye was in about 2007, and there was a famous headline in the Sunday Mail, you know, alcohol's cheaper than water. And it was at that point. It's not quite as bad as that now. But that's what that graph is trying to tell you. It's trying to tell you there's an absolutely clear relationship that if you make alcohol cheaper, more people will drink, the country will drink more and more people will die. Make alcohol more expensive, less will be drunk and more people will live.
Yeah, I understand what it's trying to tell us, and thanks for laying that out.
It's an old graph.
It would just be nice to know what the numbers meant.
Yeah, so if you could dig
that out, and also it'd be really nice to know if there's any data since then. I think that only goes up to 2000, what you said, 7 or so. If there's anything beyond that for the last 15 years or so, would be really helpful to see.
I could show you many graphs that are. I'm happy to provide that data to you. Okay, but the point is that at any time point in any country, any time it's been looked at, that relationship holds good.
That's fine. So moving on, I've got in terms of the effect on the industry, I've got a couple of data points here, and I just want to again clarify those because we're going to talk to those with another panel later on. There's an IFS study that says £383 million per year. It's called windfall gains to the sector, and I'm not sure if that's increased revenue or increased profit or net profit or what that number is. And then there's also a Sheffield model of £140 million. That is a revenue number, so clearly that won't translate through to profit. So I don't know if any of you are on top of any of those numbers. If not, it's not a problem.
I wouldn't go so far as to say I'm on top of them, but I think all of the estimates are using different approaches to try and estimate the revenue increase to the supply chain. Okay. And, you know, Fraser Vallander Institute did a calculation for us, which came out at 30 million per year. And as you've alluded to, the IFS is an order of magnitude greater than that per year. But you're right that revenue does not equate to profit.
An IFS number, is that a Scotland number or a UK number? It's a Scotland number. It must be, I think, Scotland. So there's also a number we've got in here of just short of £1 million a year saved on NHS costs, which I can understand the way that's been calculated, and that it's good to see that. Are you aware, or do you have any data on the cost of alcohol harm to the overall economy?
I can answer that, because we got we commissioned the Social Market Foundation to do some work, to update some work they've done for the UK-wide some years ago, specifically for Scotland. And it depends on what parameters you use. These are always estimates, you know, because you can take account of the healthcare costs we've spoken about, the social costs, the policing costs, disorder, etc. But if you start getting into calculations on years of life lost, one of the things about alcohol, it kills people in their middle years, unlike most other conditions which we can discuss, kill people, you know, once they're beyond working life. So if you want to be brutally honest, you're losing productive people. And the estimate is somewhere between 5 and 10 billion. Now, that's a big estimate, you know, that's a big error bar.
Is that a UK level or a Scottish level?
That's in Scotland, 5 to 10 billion pounds.
Of economic activity.
That's the cost, right, including years of life lost.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. That's helpful and puts some of the other numbers we're talking about today into some kind of context. Thanks very much. Last thing I wanted to focus on was just in terms of the uprating. Your perspective on that. What should the mechanism be? Should it be automatic? Should it be based on inflation or affordability? Or I'm going back to the graph you just shown us there. Keen to get anyone's perspectives on how we should take this forward.
Well, I'd take that briefly and maybe then pass on. We touched on affordability. Mm-hmm. In an ideal world, you'd have an instantly available measure of affordability. And, you know, affordability might change year on year, depending on whether you're in a recession or a boom economy. And so in an ideal world, you would uprate it in relation to affordability, and it might go up and down year on year. In reality, the data on affordability always lags behind by several years. You know, for example, we don't actually have affordability data since 2021, and we've had the cost of living crisis since then. So inflation is the next best measure you've got. One of the striking things about the inflation in the past few years has been how alcohol inflation has been much less than food inflation or general inflation. So actually alcohol prices haven't gone up, so alcohol has become relatively cheaper compared to the other products. If I had my way, there would be a regular uprating. Automatic would be best because it takes the heat out of the situation. But if you don't have some sort of regular uprating mechanism, you're consigning MEP to be progressively less effective year on year. And that's one of the reasons why we're having this discussion. You know, we're almost 6 years into it, and we're talking about that reducing effect. So automatic if possible, if not that regular. Affordability would be the gold standard, but I think inflation is a good second best.
Thank you. Anyone else, Alison?
If I may, from the Sheffield modelling, it's clear that if we leave the price at 50 pence, then we will see harm go up. If we were to raise it to 65 pence per unit, then over 5 years, 800 lives would be saved. 10,000 hospital admissions would be averted, and £12 million would be saved in hospital costs. So that's gives you a comparator for the two price levels over the next 5 years.
Okay.
I'm happy to add in there that we are very much in favour of uprating and then automatically continuing that on. It makes no sense whatsoever to have, you know, put all of our eggs in the basket of this policy, which actually, as Alistair was saying, the price was fixed in 2012, I think, and then to wonder why it's maybe having less and less impact over time. So I think if we are to become once again world leading in terms of alcohol policy, we have to, you know, look at a reasonable price point for MUP.
Yeah, and it's interesting. You all have seen, because it was public, the first session we had this morning on upgrading social care payments. It's just a percentage increase, and it's a very relatively painless process. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you. Gillian Mackay.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning to the panel. If MUP was to continue, would witnesses support the introduction of a levy to recoup the additional revenue from retailers as outlined in the Scottish Budget? And Justina's nodding, so I'll go to Justina first.
Thank you. Yeah, I mean, it's something that families really, really support. You know, that sort of polluter pays idea that, you know, if you're making money through alcohol, that should definitely be put back into treatment. So, yeah, very much in support of that.
very much in support of that, just for exactly what Justina says.
There's a wide range of organisations who support uplifting MUP and the introduction of a levy. I mean, the likelihood is that if you raise the price of MUP, there will be additional profits. It's been very difficult. It's not been possible to quantify what that translates into in terms of profit. But it's pretty clear that the producers think that the retailers are making more money. And, you know, in a common sense analysis, we are buying less alcohol, but we are paying more for it. So the likelihood is that shops are making more money. There was a public health supplement in Scotland between 2012 and 2015 that applied to large supermarkets who sold both alcohol and tobacco. There has been some discussion about whether that may potentially be reintroduced, and we would strongly support that. We think it's both unfair that shops, supermarkets should profit from minimum unit price, but we also think that it's unhelpful that it should be more profitable to sell alcohol, because that could encourage other shops which currently don't sell alcohol to move into selling alcohol.
That's great. Would the witnesses prefer this to be a levy to take the form of a public health supplement or a social responsibility levy? And what do witnesses believe that revenue should be put back into? Come back to Alison first.
I think everybody on this panel supports the alcohol harms prevention levy, which is a form of the public health supplement that would apply to retailers who sell alcohol. And that would be levied on non-domestic rates, as the public health supplement was. A 13 pence rate would bring in £57 million per year. We believe that could be used at local level for improving treatment. We've heard that treatment services are inadequate. We've seen a 40% reduction in treatment services over the last 10 years. Also, people in recovery are saying that their recovery groups are struggling financially. So investing at local level in those recovery groups and support would be extremely helpful. And also for preventative activity, there are projects going on at the moment around Scotland that are involving communities, children and parents in trying to get more sustainable change in alcohol consumption at local level. Investment in those and similar activities would be very welcome.
Just add to that, obviously in terms of drugs, we've got the National Drugs Mission, a huge investment of £250 million over 5 years as part of that. Although alcohol actually causes more harm and causes more deaths as well. So it seems to me a very obvious mechanism to use to be able to identify funds that we could then put back out to communities, treatment, support and recovery services. Really, really important.
That's great. And what do the panel believe that the total benefit of minimum unit pricing, if we were to bring that social responsibility levy public health supplement back in terms of the public health benefit of minimum unit pricing in itself and the difference we've seen that make, but also that additional revenue going back into services in terms of both treatment and preventative services? What is that whole bundle looking like?
Yes, I think it's a win-win, or a win-win-win, if you like. Perhaps one of the lessons that we've learned compared to when MUP was first introduced is that we've heard about the concern about the effect on dependent drinkers, that 1% of the population and how they need to support them. So I think that at the same time as we're introducing or continuing MUP and hopefully uprating it to an appropriate level, it's really the ideal time to focus on improving services for treatment. And that takes money, that takes resources. So it's a win-win to use some of that windfall increased revenue to plough into the public purse to be put into alcohol services.
That's great. Thanks, Convener.
And Carol Mokin.
Thank you. Possibly just a short follow-up to Justin, if you don't mind. I'm interested, often the alcohol industry advises that they already
you know, put some money into funding services. Do you think that that model or the levy model might allow us to put money better into public services and be able to use it across Scotland to support the harms that you've spoken about? How would you see that working out?
Well, I think it's preferable for a number of reasons. First of all, it's focusing on large-scale retailers, so there's a direct link between how much money is raised and the amount of money that's coming through, you know, alcohol sales. But also, there's that local decision-making. You know, it would be a levy where the money goes back to local areas. There's, you know, it's community-oriented in terms of how that funding is used. And I think we do want to see in every local area that people have got a choice. You know, some people will need hospital treatment, but other people may want, you know, community-based counselling or, you know, a recovery community, and we need family support in every area. So I think that then lets local communities determine how the funds are spent. And it's not so directly linked to the alcohol industry and maybe trying to get some PR out of sponsoring a community project and having their branding, for example, on show.
OK, that's helpful. Thank you.
And Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Convener. I just wanted to get a greater clarity on each panellist's view on the benefits of a public health supplement vis-a-vis a social responsibility levy. I know certainly, Ms Douglas, you mentioned that a public health supplement might be your preference. Is there any other particular views on that distinction?
I mean, I'm not a legislator. I'm not related to that. I can give you a very sort of a educated guess, but as an outsider, you know, we know the public health supplement is readily implementable, and we know that it worked. I think the social responsibility levy is a bit more uncertain in terms of how easy it would be to implement and what effect it has. So, in terms of the practicalities, I'd probably prefer the supplement.
Okay. Any other strong views or particular views?
Yeah, I agree with Alistair, and this is about making sure whatever form it takes, let's look at the easiest option, let's get money where it needs to be, local communities, to reduce harm in relation to problematic drinking. So yeah, the easiest way possible for those communities to make decisions. And my experience is local communities understand the problems and they have their own solutions, and they can drive those solutions. So that's where the money needs to go, in the most easiest way possible, and that would be through the public health approach.
Yeah. I agree. Yep.
Okay, yeah, that's great. Just also wanted to clarify, you mentioned about local communities having a degree of democratic oversight of the proceeds of that supplement. Would that be money that would flow to a health and social care partnership, or would it reside with a different organisation?
I'll turn to Alison for the mechanics, but okay. My understanding is there'll be local control over spend.
Yeah.
Okay.
So I think... We've seen with the drugs mission that there was a political commitment to an extra £50 million per year. I think that's probably what we would like to see in relation to the public health supplement, that there is that commitment and that can then be scrutinised by the Parliament. But the money would go back to local authorities, who, of course, are key partners in local alcohol and drug partnerships. And those partnerships are used to looking at the money available and how best to deploy it. So that's where these decisions should be made.
Have you any modelling evidence of what scale a public health supplement could sit at relative to MUP in the overall price split or price share?
So I think there, in the Fraser Vallander Institute research that was published yesterday, that used a poundage rate equivalent to the previous public health supplement of 13 pence in the pound, and that would raise total revenue of £57 million across Scotland. It modelled where the money would come from local areas. I don't think it modelled how it would be then returned to local areas, but that would be using pre-existing formula for local allocations.
That's great. Very helpful. Thank you.
And Emma Harper.
It's just a question about your thoughts on advertising or alcohol advertising, for instance. I was reading a Lancet article that basically said that a third of the people on the planet die based on four sectors. So it's fossil fuels, alcohol, ultra-high processed food and tobacco. So what are your thoughts on what needs to happen as far as advertising in order to reduce the harm from alcohol?
And can committee members be extremely brief as we have 1.5 minutes to go?
I think it's really abundantly clear from the international evidence that alcohol marketing drives consumption of alcohol. There's a causal link between exposure of young people and children to alcohol marketing and initiation of drinking, increasing drinking in those who are already drinking and the likelihood in the longer term of them going on to develop an alcohol problem. People in recovery also tell us how alcohol marketing affects their daily lives in terms of being a risk to them maintaining that recovery. And all of us, frankly, are affected by marketing. We may think that it's other people that are affected by marketing, but we see it in all sorts of decisions that we make, and alcohol marketing is part of that, because we're encouraged and in thinking that alcohol is glamorous, it's the way that we connect with friends and family, that it is an integral part of our lives and something that we should be using on a weekly, if not a daily basis, whereas we know, as we've heard today, the immense harm which alcohol causes. So tackling marketing has to be part of the wider mix of measures that we take in Scotland.
Sandra Kulhani for a declaration of interest.
Thank you, Fiona. Apologies, I didn't declare my interest as a practising NHS GP.
Thank you. Can I thank the witnesses for their attendance today, and I'll suspend the meeting.
We now continue our post-legislative scrutiny of the Alcohol Minimum Pricing Scotland Act 2012 with a second panel of witnesses, and I welcome to the committee Dr. Pete Chima, OBE, Chief Executive of the Scottish Grocers Federation, Bob Price, Director and Policy Advisor of National Association of Cider Makers, who joins us online, David Richardson, who also joins us online, Regulatory and Commercial Affairs Director of the Wine and Spirit Trade Association, and Paul Watterson, Honorary President and former CEO of the Scottish Licensed Trade Association. And we move straight to questions. And I'm going to just kick off here. So on the previous panel, where we heard evidence from alcohol health charities, and I'm paraphrasing slightly here because I don't have the official record in front of me, but one of the panel members spoke about minimum unit pricing being one of the most scrutinised public health measures that there's been. Now, we know that there was previously robust challenges to the introduction of, from sections of the alcohol industry. So I wonder to what extent do witnesses contest Public Health Scotland's conclusion that their evaluation of MUP showed strong evidence that the policy had reduced chronic alcohol deaths and hospital admissions. Who'd like to start there?
Very happy to kick off.
Thank you.
I think the COVID-19 pandemic and the fluctuations in behaviour, particularly the increase in costs in hospitality and online consumption, mitigates really significantly skews on any data collected since March 2020.
Sorry, I didn't quite catch that there.
So the COVID-19 pandemic,
yeah,
and the subsequent fluctuations in behaviour, in particular the increased costs in hospitality and online unlicensed consumption, I think mitigates any significant skews on any data collected since March 2020. So it's our view that it's essential that MUP remains at 50 pence, but I don't think there's been a real opportunity to assess the impact on the policy, on the impacts on the policy because of the pandemic.
So you're challenging what Public Health Scotland had said?
Well, I think the data is skewed, and I think we have to assess it, you know, for a longer period of time to make sure that the data is correct.
And how, in what way are you challenging the data? Because that's quite a challenge to Public Health Scotland.
Well, we're challenging
it. What evidence do you have?
Because it was such a... If you understand what happened under COVID-19, a lot of the stores were closed, people weren't allowed to go out, people had to stay in, so there was behavioural changes which were really quite different to what we were experiencing now and what we would normally experience in day-to-day running. So I think we need to see the data for a longer period of time than just that period that it was assessed at.
And you're doing that on what basis, what scientific basis, what evidence basis?
Well, I think the scientific basis is, you know, very, very clear in front of you, because there was such a behavioural change during that period that the data has to be skewed.
OK, so essentially the Scottish Grocers Federation doesn't accept Public Health Scotland's evaluation of minimum unit pricing on the basis of anecdote?
That's right.
OK, thank you. Sandesh Gulhani.
Thank you, Convener. Just to declare my interest as a practising NHS GP at the start. So can I just come back to you, please? So, you know, we looked at Public Health Scotland's modelling. And it was modelling, because real-world deaths have gone up. And they've modelled it against England, whilst if they modelled it against Wales, we would have seen no difference, which is what Wales have found. And if we modelled it against Northern Ireland, we'd have actually seen that MUP exacerbated deaths. And so that to me, is a bit of a concern when it comes to the way the data was collected. I just wondered what your thoughts were about that.
It's... It, it's very, very difficult to assess when we've had such unprecedented times. So I think in reality we need a longer period of time to collect data to make sure that everything's correct.
And if I could turn to those who are online, if I may, I'd sort of like to look at the studies that have been produced by Public Health Scotland, where 8 studies looked at health outcomes. 1 study showed some changes, but it was clear that dependent drinkers were doing very badly. Women drinkers also did rather badly, and wondered what your thoughts were about that, but also how we could help those groups.
I wonder if I could come in here, please. Thank you for the opportunity to give evidence to the committee. It's always a challenge to challenge data that's been painstakingly collected by a number of different groups over a period of time. I think my main point here is that I'd refer the committee to the evaluation report produced by the University of Sheffield, which said there was no significant change in the proportion of drinkers consuming at harmful or moderate levels after the introduction of MUP, which I think reflects the point that you've just made. And our view of how do you get to the groups that don't do very well under MUP is that you don't have a population measure. You don't have a measure that we say penalises the moderate responsible drinker, but you have targeted measures. Now, there's various ways of targeting measures, but the one that we would promote is one called Community Alcohol Partnerships, which has got a very long track record of tackling and reducing underage drinking, and does so in collaboration with retailers, with regulators, with local authorities in the area it works. It doesn't come with alcohol sponsorship badging. It comes with Community Alcohol Partnership badging, and it's a very clear program that has a track record of success in targeting a particular group, underage drinkers, and we would very much recommend that sort of targeted response as opposed to a population measure. Thank you.
Thank you. We heard in the previous panel that there has been money generated. Now, we're not sure how much. It could be between 90 million over 3 years to 200 million. We're not sure. But my question to you is, it's clear that money has been generated from MUP, but who's got that money? Where is it physically going? Whose pocket has that ended up
in? That's an extremely good question, and it's something that I'm very, very concerned about, because what I'm hearing from other witnesses from various committees that I've sat on is that people conflate turnover, revenue, with profit, how much money people have. And if prices go up but consumption go down, it doesn't automatically follow that turnover goes up. If turnover goes up in a retailer, it doesn't automatically follow that their profit goes up, because they have other costs as well, responding to COVID, national minimum wage, energy crisis. I'm sure we could list others, all of which affect profit. And we don't know what conversations that have gone on between retailers, wholesalers and producers of alcoholic products about the price at which retailers get the products in their hands. And there's then an issue that even if some of that increased turnover goes to wholesalers and producers, it again doesn't necessarily translate into profit. Now, I absolutely can't say to you that nobody has made a profit out of this, because I'm sure we could comb through accounts and find somebody who has. But I think you would need a lot more evidence about what's happened to people's turnover as a result of MUP, and then what has happened to profit as a result of that, before you could draw any sustainable conclusions about how much money there has been and exactly where it's gone.
Thank you. I mean, a big concern I have is MEP shouldn't be generating profit. You know, I don't feel that that should be what it does. It should be helping people. And so it would be very helpful to know where the money is so that we could try to use that money to help people that need it, especially those who are most dependent upon alcohol. My last question is about what else we could be doing from a retailer's point of view to try to help people who are drinking to harmful levels and dependency. So I know we've spoken about community alcohol partnerships, but what else could we do? Because we heard in the previous committee, Tracy saying that we need a suite of tools, but there doesn't seem to be others. And we've also heard Justina say that what about everything else when it comes to measures to help? So does industry have some ideas of what else we could be doing?
Are you talking specifically about advertising here?
I'm talking about anything.
There are a lot of measures in terms of industry voluntary codes around marketing. So the Portman Group Code is well known for challenging and taking products off the shelf that have a particular appeal to children, or that promote products on the basis that they will make you a more appealing human being. So there are those measures that again are effective and known to work. But I think what you're looking at is a series of voluntary codes and education around responsibility, because I think it's always tempting for government to legislate, whereas we would suggest that you can get at least a large part of the result you want through cooperation and discussion.
Thank you.
And before I move on, I'll declare my interest. Thank you for reminding me there, Dr. Gilhani, in that I am a registered nurse with a bank contract with NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde. And I'll move to Ivan McGee.
Thanks very much, and good morning to the panel. I just want to dig in a bit deeper into the question that Dr. Gilhani asked about revenue and where it's going. I suppose I'm, maybe concerned is too strong a word, but perplexed as to why we don't have better data on this. And if you look at the wide range of estimates or models on what the additional revenue flowing into the system has been, as Dr. Gohani said, that ranges from 30-odd million to 300-odd million per year. And I've thought the sector would have had a better handle on those numbers. Now, I absolutely take the point that's been made that the whole point of this is to reduce consumption. So if you double the price and you only sell half as much, your revenue hasn't gone up at all. So it's quite clear to say that it's possible there hasn't been any extra revenue, but it could have been quite a significant number depending on those numbers. And then, as you rightly said, the profit calculation on that is even more complicated because of the various layers within the supply chain and what they're all charging each other. And again, it's common sense. If you're selling less, your unit price, of course, to produce and distribute is going to, and to sell is going to increase as well. So just throwing this out there, is anybody on the panel get any reliable data that we can talk to and put on the record with regards to what money may have additionally been coming through retailers and where they think it may have ended up?
Getting data from supermarkets must be one of the hardest things to get. I mean, we had the public health supplement a number of years ago, which added 13 pence, depending on ratable values, which was meant to be used, I think, for this purpose. It was stopped after a couple of years. Don't know why it was stopped. It kicked in at 300,000. It was targeted at supermarkets, and they paid that money in. And I think over the 2 years, there was about 95, or 3 years, there was about £95 million in its lifespan. So the money's there, I think. Perhaps that £300,000 ceiling could be brought down to about £100,000. That would protect smaller shops. I think it's really the supermarkets that should be targeted to this. So it's been in place before, and there's figures relating to that.
Yeah, with respect, that's very different to what we're talking about here, because that was a tax which raised an amount of revenue, which, you're right, there's data on that. But in terms of the additional revenue that has flown through retailers and up the supply chain directly as a consequence of MUP, if there's any data on that specifically.
Yeah, I get that, but it's the model that you've used before, and you know what the figures are. Is there more profit? Well, we'll never know, will we? Okay. It's as simple as that. You'll never get the data, because they used alcohol as a loss leader for years, so they're using something else as a loss leader now.
Well, we've got four industry experts in the room, so I would hope that one of you may have at least something data on it. So does anyone else want to comment?
I think it is genuinely very hard to get that data, because let's take a product that was previously sold below MUP and is now subject to MUP, and you can see what happens to the volumes of that product. You don't necessarily know if those customers of that product trade up to a different product or keep buying the same one. So it becomes quite hard to associate the activity with the measure that's in place. And I think in a more general sense, this is the challenge that MUP faces of causation versus association. And in terms of industry data, you can get quite easily the published accounts of supermarkets through Companies House to start drilling down to their management accounts and seeing how particular lines have performed and how particular lines have then competed against or worked with each other. You're not going to get that data out of supermarkets or brand owners, I'm afraid, and they're not going to tell us that as a trade association.
Okay, I mean, I'll leave it there, but I just find it strange, having been in business, that people whose day job it is to know these numbers don't have a perspective on it. But moving on to talk about the uprating, and I think there was the Grocers Federation submission made a comment about you didn't think there was any reason to increase the 50% rate because wage inflation hadn't kept pace with price inflation. I'm not sure how true that is with recent wage inflation data, but does that mean that you're comfortable with an increase that reflected wage inflation rather than price inflation, and it's just the inflation calculation you're disputing rather than the concept of uprating?
Look, I think what's important is that that our industry has suffered quite a lot. You know, we've got the cost of living crisis. We've not had the same rates relief as our English and Welsh counterparts have had, despite the Scottish Government having the consequentials given to them of £568 million. That has never been actually passed onto the retail, convenience or hospitality sector. So we're at a considerable disadvantage there. And, you know, we all know about the rate of inflation, the rate of interest, and we're also aware of the increased costs that we're having to incur. So I want to just go back to what you had said about, you know, where is all this profit going? No business actually takes into account one sector. It's just the overall basket spend in the store. So that's where the profit, you know, is determined from. But you've got to also remember that convenience stores are now, for the very first time, able to play a level playing field with supermarkets, who were traditionally able to reduce the price of alcohol in order to encourage footfall. So, you know, putting that to one side, we honestly believe that the MUP should stay at the current level. It shouldn't be increased because, one, we don't have the proper data. Number two, there are, in my view, or in the Federation's view, that there is no specific data to see why it should be increased, because there's no correlation at this moment to say that an increased MUP will have actually reduce the number of deaths in alcohol. Having said that, you know, if you are to increase the MUP, then we should be given at least a minimum of 12 months in order to react to that, in order to adjust the prices throughout the supply chain, the stock that we hold, replace the shelf edge and install labelling, reprogramming the tills, payment systems and new formulas, etc. So that's where the Federation stands.
Final question on this, and again, I'm quite perplexed also on this. Effectively, what this is an opportunity for retailers, convenience stores, grocers to increase prices without increasing costs, right? And I'm not clear why you see this as such an economic challenge to the sector, unless you can unpick the earlier question about who's charging who more for this and what the data is telling you about reduced revenue and reduced profit, if that is the case as a consequence of this.
Look, I think I've answered that question quite adequately just a few moments ago. But what I don't understand about this line of questioning is profit such a rude word for business? Are we not here to make a profit? Are we all here to make a loss so that there is no business? Why do you want to destroy a business that is so highly regarded in the world? You know, like Scotch whiskey, for example, and so forth. You know, why do you want to destroy something like that where if it's doing well, we should be commended to say our industry in Scotland is doing well. We should be actually encouraging that sector, not absolutely saying, no, we want to absolutely destroy it. If it's making too much profit, then we should be reducing that. Is that the way the economic world in your eyes works?
I think you're asking the wrong person that question. I was 30 years in business before I came into politics, and I've run a lot of very profitable businesses. The question I'm asking you is
here
about
to answer the questions, yeah, not the committee.
The question I'm asking is about basic economics and trying to understand. If somebody said to me, when I was running a business, you've got the opportunity to increase prices without increasing costs, I would have seen that as a positive, not a negative. And I'm just trying to understand the basis on which you see it as an economic challenge to the sector rather than an economic opportunity.
Because our stores are embedded in the communities. You know, we can see if people are drinking too much, our stores generally will take, we know each and every one of our customers. We will try and discourage those people not from drinking. That's the essence of MUP. We know the issues, we know the problems, and we, you know, our stores are the first port of call. And you've got to remember, during the COVID-19 pandemic, our stores were considered to be the fourth emergency service.
OK, thank you.
David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. Just a quick supplementary. I find that everybody that's represented here, that nobody could tell me where his profit has went to. Everybody who sells alcohol needs an operating plan. I spent the last few weeks going through 5 councils' licensing papers and new applications. Every one of them, a majority of them were for extensions of sales of alcohol, especially in small grocers. So you tell me, if they are not making a profit, who would not be extending the area to sell alcohol? So it has to come from bigger retailers, and small grocers are definitely getting that profit. You could go through all licensing papers, and I bet if you check that with every local authority, the number of people who are putting in for extensions to sell alcohol shows that they are making a greater profit off it.
Convenience retailers offer a wide range of services, and in order to remain viable, they have to share the additional costs of being a smaller business across and their products and services. The reduction in the viability of one product area means that there will have to be increases elsewhere and across the range, and ultimately adding to inflation and the cost of living crisis for customers. You know, we don't want it to be such that Mrs. Smith can't enjoy her Saturday night tipple.
Is it not that you expand an area to sell a goods if you're making greatest profit off it?
I can't really comment on one area, you know, in Fife that may have applied for additional licensing, you know, and
that's
not, times.
That's over several different licensing boards.
Yeah.
The number of applications to extend areas of selling alcohol, which shows that these shops are making greater profit from it, because you would not change an area.
Could there not be the fact that convenience stores are finding it very, very difficult to sell, dry goods, for example, foods, because of the increase in supermarkets and the increase of discounters. So they're trying to decrease the area for those products. And could it not be that they see that that is the only viable opportunity for them to make a profit?
I would argue against that, because the small paper shop I go to every day doesn't sell alcohol at all. It's been there 20 years, very successful.
Look, there are different types of stores, you know. There's always been traditionally newspaper stores that sell nothing but newspapers, magazines and sweets. And then there are those that have always been selling alcohol. So I think they're just different types of stores. And that's always going to be the case in business. You know, there's always going to be different types of businesses.
So I think David Richardson wants to come in, followed by Bob Price.
Thank you, Convener. I just wanted to go back to Mr. McKee's point about the opportunity to increase prices without increasing cost. Isn't that a good thing for retailers? I'd argue not necessarily, because first of all, increasing prices might not attract customers. And secondly, it's not just the costs to the retailer that matters, it's the cost up the rest of the supply chain. If there is consumer resistance to a particular product, then producers might want to look at how to repackage it or reformulate it to change the ABV. And we saw in the implementation of MUP, certainly in the first year, there very much was an increased cost to industry across the supply chain in terms of what people had to achieve in order to deliver MUP. Now, in fairness, that became business as usual, and MUP became more or less embedded. But it's not a cost-free exercise. Thank you.
Yeah, just very briefly on that, Convener, if I may, thanks very much. No, you're absolutely right, and I, of course, understand all of that as being factors. The point I think I'm trying to make is that we've already established to the earlier question that you don't have the data to understand where the revenue and the profit is and where it's flowing up and down the supply chain and what the impact has been, and what the impact has been on volume, and what the impact has been on revenue and so on and so forth. So without that data, I'm struggling to understand how such a strong case is being made that this is a bad thing for retailers without the data to back that up, when it may well be, as we've said, a good thing, depending on exactly what those numbers are that nobody seems to know.
Can I come in at this point, please?
Yes, please.
Thank you very much. I'm Bob Price. I represent the National Association of Cider Makers. Cider is not a mainstream product in Scotland. In fact, at the very moment, only 10% of the cider made in the UK makes its way to Scotland, England being by far the largest market. Since MUP was introduced, the data that we have has pointedly shown that cider sales in Scotland have fallen by 60%. And strong cider sales, which was principally the target of MEP in the very first place, has dropped by 82%. And at the end of the day, there's very little strong cider. And when I say strong, anything above 5.5% ABV. Mainstream cider sales, that's 4.5% ABV to 5.5%, have also fallen. And that fall is 33%. So from the cider maker's point of view, no money at all is being made in Scotland. There's a residual market which is being fed by companies, but it's a market that's in serious decline and almost being put out of existence in Scotland. So there's no profit or money or revenue being made by our industry in Scotland. Thank you.
Thanks very much. It'll help to get data points. Just clarify, is that by value or by volume?
Volume.
Right. OK, so the value number won't be obviously as dramatic a reduction as that, because the price will be more than doubled in many cases. But thanks very much for that data.
Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Convener. Clearly, the picture of retail revenue impacts is difficult to ascertain, given the lack of data, as has been described by panel members. But I've just heard from the Association of Cider Makers representative. I'm keen to understand more about the secondary impacts on manufacturing. Is there any evidence from brewers and distillers that the feared consequences for the industry following the introduction of MOP has happened? For example, lower manufacturing revenue or discontinuation of certain products? Are there specific instances, firms or products that any panellists can point to? that's fine. Is there any indication that minimum unit pricing has contributed to a levelling of the playing field between the on-trade and off-trade, and has this perhaps been a benefit in particular to the on-trade?
The whole point of MUP was to see the government getting involved in pricing, which was revolutionary, really. The relationship between low prices and increased consumption and the potential misuse is as obvious as it is dangerous to us. If we just go back for a while, after the 1976 Act, there was an explosion in the amount of licences all over on and off trade. But in the on trade, towards the end of the 80s and through the 90s, we saw a lot of irresponsible promotions and so on, happy hours, drinking games and so on, which made people drink more than they would normally and faster than they would normally. So the SLTA was very clear when we moved towards the 2006 Act that we had to do something about it. The extra competition was forcing prices down. That was leading to the abuse of alcohol, and we had to try and stop these drinks promotions. And we managed to get those drinks promotions stopped, and we don't see them really now at all in the on-trade. But little did we know that another group would be standing around to exploit that, and that was supermarkets. Now, if you're chasing profit, it shouldn't be achieved at any cost. We're licensed for a very good reason. Trends will come and go. Supermarkets will come and go. But one thing always remains constant, and that's alcohol is potentially dangerous and it must be respected. Now, when you're giving alcohol away, basically, you're making no profit out of it and you're using it as a loss leader to get people into stores to make profit off of other things, that's fine. But not when it comes to a licensed product, because it creates abuse. So eventually, the Scottish Government of the time decided that they should stop some of the promotions on alcohol in supermarkets and in other shops. But it couldn't be prescriptive enough because supermarkets kept getting around it. And that's why we needed MUP to bring the standards up again to those that didn't take the responsibilities, and we've heard about that already this morning, seriously. It was profit and nothing. No responsibility, no adherence to licensing laws. If they didn't like the licensing laws in supermarkets, they would challenge them. They would challenge the local boards and usually win. So how did we do it? We did it through minimum unit pricing. And I think that was the right way to go. We've supported that for many, many years. I think it must be one of the most scrutinised acts that we've ever had in this country. I might be wrong, but certainly 40-odd studies looking at every aspect of it, taking into account COVID, to tremendous detail there, and showing it's been very positive. So the SLT is very clear, very, very clear that we support it, minimum unit pricing. We always have done. If you look at the level of it at the moment, I think that what we should be doing is put some sort of mechanism in for putting it up or indeed putting it down if it's not proportionate to the problem, which that was why it was brought in, to be proportionate to the problem. So certainly we would support that level going up, but to what level, I think it's to be left to others.
Quick supplement, John, your view on, you mentioned earlier the public health supplement, which was previously introduced and then discontinued. Are you supportive of reintroduction?
Yeah, absolutely. My problem with personally, that money is, how do you hive that money off for what it's for? How do we make sure that money is ring-fenced? I think ring-fencing of money is very, very difficult if it's given back out to councils, or how are they going to use it? We all know that councils are strapped for cash, but certainly we would see it, but protecting the smaller shops through rateable value. I think it should be, our way of looking at it would be to a ceiling of about 100,000 on it. Anything above 100,000 should pay that.
Okay, thanks.
David Torrance.
Actually, just on that point, the witnesses before us and all the charities dealing with alcohol-related diseases, problems, have all called for an alcohol levy, as was up until 2015. And I'm going to go to every one of you to ask if you're in favour of alcohol levy and for the money raised to be put back into these different organisations that help support people with alcohol addiction and families and things like that.
We would support it if we could guarantee it was used for that purpose. And it should be used through the off-trade, as I said, for rateable values over £100,000. Yeah, we would certainly see it. We made, what was it, £95 million over 2 years on it.
Yep.
Supermarkets, it wouldn't be that big a dent in their profit, I'm sure, between them.
Could I ask other witnesses if you're in favour of it?
I'm very much in favour of targeted measures to help people who need help. I'm not convinced that a levy, an extra business taxation, is necessarily the right way to go about it, when there's probably more that can be done through voluntary and cooperative measures. Thanks.
It's a very, very difficult question, but I think our view would be much the same as Paul's, but as long as it protects the convenience sector. And I think that's very, very important, because I think, you know, we've been fairly disadvantaged to date. And if that money was actually ring-fenced for that factor and we're protected, then I have no problem with that at all.
Mr. Price.
Thank you. If you imposed a levy
on the cider industry. You'd be applying it to manufacturers. Manufacturers are getting no benefit whatsoever from MUP, so you're just taking more money away from manufacturers that they have already lost through MUP. Pricing is retailer, not a manufacturer basis. We're not allowed to set selling prices, only retailers are. So you're just taking extra money that we've not been able to get from the marketplace. So I can't see that that achieves any benefit other than driving the industry out of Scotland.
Could I come back there? Just to give an example, Diageo, which is situated in my constituency, and Genuinely Roofs, made £4.6 billion profit alone last year from its alcohol sales. And I know both of you have agreed that if the levy was there and it was targeted, it could go there. But Mr Price and Mr Richardson, do you think the taxpayer should pay for the damage that alcohol does and pay for all the NHS, all the different treatments, all these different charities, and not contribute something which could be targeted back to help?
Well, you know the answer to that is that all businesses pay taxes. We pay exorbitant rates in the on-trade in Scotland. Exorbitant rates. I think, you know, we can be talking about two different things. We would like to see the same model as the public health supplement, which was very much off-trade, very much supermarkets, protect the smaller operators. It wasn't for producers. I don't see the relationship there in producers. This was really, I think, identifying at the time where the problems were stemming from. The vast, vast majority of alcohol in this country, you might have heard figures previously, are sold by about 7 or 8 operators. So it appears to me if you've got a problem with alcohol, you know who the 7 or 8 operators that are most responsible for selling it and trying always to keep the price down to sell more. So you know who that is. So it's quite simple to say that's who should be targeted, and that's supermarkets. The supermarkets that caused a lot of the through ridiculously low prices, not adhering to the licensing acts, not having the moral obligations that licence holders should have if they were licensed, who caused a lot of the alcohol problems in this country. So knowing that and knowing where it's coming from, it should be those people, not the smaller operators or pubs who are bounded by licensing, severely bounded by who they can sell to, when they can sell it, the age and so on, and all the other licensing restrictions that we have, and rightly so. It shouldn't be that the smaller operators or the pubs or the bars or the hotels or the restaurants that should be paying that. It should be the main people who are responsible for the problem in the first place and keeping it to a certain extent going. We know who it is that's selling most.
Thank you for that.
Sandra Gohani.
Thank you, Convener. I was speaking to a small business, a retailer, who said that when she sells alcohol, she listens to conversations that are going on because she knows that, and we'll name a brand, Dragon Soup, is very popular with children because of how sweet it is. And parents are buying it for their kids. And when she hears a parent texting or calling their kids to say which one is it you wanted, she refuses to sell it to them, diminishing her profits, but she feels that's the right thing to do. So convenience stores do a lot of good when it comes to looking at this. So the question that I have when we look at a way of producing money in a levy or using the money generated in MUP, we've agreed we don't know where that is, so maybe we do need to find out where that money is. But would it not be very useful to put that money back into education, back into alcohol brief interventions, and back into actual targeted help for people to try to reduce the harms?
I think I mentioned in my opening remarks that convenience stores are embedded in society, and we know our customers. And when we see there is an outright abuse of alcohol, we try to stop it. And I think you've made that remark quite adequately. So, in terms of responsible retailing, we're there. It was the SGF that introduced Challenge 25 almost 30 years ago, which has now been implemented right across the UK. So, in terms of responsible retailing, we're there. We have supported the Scottish Government with the MUP, and we were glad it actually levelled out the playing field, because large supermarkets, as Paul's mentioned quite neatly, that they were the cause of the issues. They were the ones that were selling alcohol, sometimes, at the cost of price of water, and it did cause problems. So the introduction of MUP at 50 pence has been very much warranted. It's been welcomed by our sector. In terms of, SGF has always implemented education over everything. I think it's absolute key. Now, if you look at, where that money's going to come from, then because of the amount of cost rises that are occurring in our industry, in our sector, we would find it very, very difficult to contribute any further. But I think that's for the Scottish Government to take on.
So very, very briefly, so do Paul and Pete, do you feel that we should have supermarkets in front of us to ask similar questions to?
Yeah, I hope you get an answer out of it. Because it's very, very difficult. I know Mr. McKee was saying about getting data. I mean, it's not... I don't think it's any of our jobs to get that data. And I know that in the past, when the Scottish Government have tried to get data from supermarkets, they've not got it. Yeah, supermarkets should be here to answer for themselves on what they've done over the last number of years, remembering, of course, that they were open when other businesses like ours were closed for COVID, and the profits were through the roof, for want of a better phrase. But I think if we could ring-fence that money, which is difficult, very, very difficult to do that, and it could maybe help with the groups that haven't been helped as much through MUP, alcoholism, and which is a scourge, of course, and basically a health problem. If it could help those groups... Yeah, I mean, very much so. But as I said before, it's difficult to get that money ring-fenced. The government would have to come up with a way that we could make sure that that was spent on alcohol problems and all, for the groups that haven't really been helped with MUP, which I think that one of the studies showed.
Thank you.
Emma Harper.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning to you. Just to pick up on what Dr. Pete said about education being the way that we need to go forward, I've been looking at the work of Henry Dimbleby and Chris Van Tulleken around ultra-high processed foods and how some of that isn't just about education, because we need to tackle stigma, we need to help support people in weight loss, and education isn't the only answer. So I wonder about, in relation to alcohol dependence, what opportunities are there for supermarkets, like the big ones that aren't here at the table today? What opportunities are there to maybe them change their model of selling, like goes on in Ireland, for instance, with the shop inside the shop kind of off-licence. Is that an opportunity that could help look at how we support people as well?
Well, the shop inside the shop, at the time when it was, if you remember back years ago, that was how it used to be sold. And they said alcohol at the time, I think it was AFS, might be wrong, said that as soon as it was moved into the main store, alcohol sales increased by 40%. So to go back to the shop within a shop, I think we've always advocated that. We see it in other countries. We see it in America, for instance, where they can't sell, in many states, they can't sell spirits in a supermarket. It's only beer and wine and so on. So I think that would be certainly a way forward and would allow control and also perhaps get the data, because the data always went through a different till. So maybe you might get some more data on the amount of alcohol that's actually been sold.
And the education issue is, it's not just about education. Otherwise, you know, we had to introduce laws around seatbelts, for instance, you know, in order to get people to wear seatbelts. So isn't regulation part of the process of how we help tackle alcohol harm in Scotland?
Well, the SGF runs two very successful programmes on behalf of the Scottish Government. The Healthy Living Programme, which we've been running since 2004, and also the Go Local Programme, which is now in its year 4/5. And they've been very, very successful. Education is definitely the way forward. I mean, we're part of the Scottish Alcohol Industry Partnership. We've been involved in the community alcohol partnerships. But it's interesting that the supermarkets don't seem to get involved, you know. And if you look at having, you know, if you're trying to hive off shops, alcohol into a different sector, into a convenience store, that's additional costs which some of them wouldn't be able to swallow, and it would put them out of business. So I'm sure that's not what the Scottish Government would want to see. But if that is implemented in the larger supermarkets, and let's face it, you know, they have huge sections, and if that was hived off for the larger supermarkets, then it may well help. But for the small convenience stores, it would just simply put them out of business.
Thanks.
Thanks, Convener. We focused quite a lot so far on the big retailers and rateable value and things in terms of a public health levy. But given that in some communities, small shops may be the only one that's there, and they will sell alcohol to the community that are round about, and as you correctly identified, Paul, the amount that people drink is the thing that does the harm. What is your view on a public health levy actually being linked to volume of sales rather than rateable value, and therefore the harm that those shops are actually doing to the community around them?
Well, I think it's just a matter of being pragmatic. It's getting that data and finding out who actually is selling the most. It's a difficult thing to find out. So the easiest way would probably be through rateable values. And as I said before, to protect the smaller shops, who I don't think cause the problems here. That rateable value, if it was set at 100,000, it would take the smaller shops out of that. They wouldn't have to pay it. I just think it's a matter of, yeah, I mean, it could be done, but it's very difficult to get, as we know, to get those figures on volume and who's selling the most. I think when you, people know this better than me, I think as you go down into smaller villages and so on where there aren't supermarkets, the convenience store knows everyone, gets really involved in the sale of alcohol and takes the responsibilities seriously and just wouldn't sell if they thought there was a big problem there. But people know not better than me.
I mean, alcohol accounts for just under 16% of total sales in a convenience store on average. And I think that's very, very important. But we also got to remember that communities, you know, convenience stores are really a hub of the community.
You know, is that 16% on average?
On average, yeah, of the total baskets. So it's not the most, it's not the biggest sector. What's important to remember is that convenience stores sell a whole range of services on top. You know, post offices, which don't make money. Lottery, which doesn't make money. Payment services, which don't make money. ATMs, which don't make money. In fact, most of these services are sold at a loss. And most of these services are not available in supermarkets. You know, they're just not available. You know, if they are available, you know, there's a cost implementation. You know, for example, like post offices. And we've all seen the huge problems that our sector's faced in running post offices. So you can probably imagine that, you know, that the largest counterparts are really only focusing on those products that are making them profit. And as Paul said, you know, if you look at them, the only way to do it is through reasonable value.
Thanks, convener.
Now, just check that. So 16% on average in convenience stores, just under, is alcohol, and that takes into account every other service or every other item that's sold.
Not services, just the products and products.
So you'd be counting things like cigarettes,
yes.
tobacco, newspapers.
Yeah, grocery, chilled products, fruit and veg.
Very briefly, Mr. Torrens, because we need to finish.
Does that include convenience stores which don't sell alcohol? That's covering every convenience store in Scotland. There is several of them.
That's covering convenience stores that sell alcohol.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you. Can very briefly, Mr. Yeah. McKee.
That data point on 16%, just very briefly, is that 16%, has that number gone up or gone down since the introduction of MUP?
It's a very good question and I don't know the answer.
Thank you.
The committee then to clarify that.
Sure.
Thank you.
What I can supply you is with a survey that we actually conducted, and I can leave the report here.
If you email get into email correspondence with the clerks, that's the easiest way to do that. Can I thank the committee witnesses for joining us today? Our meeting on the 20th of February, we'll be hearing from participants in the committee's recent informal engagement as part of its post-legislative scrutiny of the Social Care Self-Directed Support Act, Scotland Act 2013. And that concludes the public part of our meeting today.